Chapter 9, Hercule Poirot. Meanwhile, back in Chicago, the trail had gone cold. Poirot had expertly tracked Ben back to his apartment and then tracked him down to the underground parking lot where his car had been parked, but after that had lost the scent. Chris and Larry figured that he must have driven off in his car, but to where? Sergeant Phillips reported back to Superintendent Bristow that Wisdom had managed to get back to his apartment and freed himself from his cuffs and then had driven off in his own car, managing to evade being captured. Bristow thanked Phillips for the update and asked him now to please report back to the task force and write his statement. After he hung up, Ron put out another APB for Ben Wisdom's car so that toll roads around Chicago would see if his vehicle had passed through any booths. Living in the 21st century is considered by some to be a time when privacy has been invaded by almost every aspect of life. Big Brother is watching everywhere. However, when it comes to catching criminals, it can be immensely helpful. The mistake Ben made was he should have changed his license plate in the parking garage at his apartment complex. If he had done this one small thing, his car might never have been spotted on I-94 as it headed out of town towards Indiana. As it was, once Ron Bristow issued the second APB for Wisdom's vehicle, a dozen reports for his car were reported heading towards Gary, Indiana. After that, all reports stopped. The last toll booth that reported his car was at the Indiana state border. Ben Wisdom registered at the hotel in Detroit under the alias Richard Crichton. He had a South Carolina bank account, a driver's license, and a passport in that name, and for the past few years had been adding to his account a little bit at a time for just this emergency. He now had amassed a half-decent savings balance and could live on it for quite a while before he had to get a job. This suited him fine, as he was tired of kowtowing to all the snobs in the world of journalism. For the first couple of days, he stayed in his room and slept and watched TV. His face led the news on every TV station he found, and he learned a lot about himself. It was lucky that his disguise was so good, because he was damned if he was going to get caught at this late date. He felt he had so many more things to do.
Meanwhile, back in Chicago, everyone was panicking. The TV news had reported that a journalist, Ben Wisdom, who had worked for the Chicago Clarion, had recently been arrested for attempted murder of an unnamed female, but had escaped while he was in police custody. There was a plausible suspicion that Ben Wisdom was, in fact, the serial killer, and other major networks were reporting he was also a suspect in a string of earlier murders that had occurred in Columbia, South Carolina, before he came to live in Chicago. Mike Jenkins had called me into his office the morning after Melissa Henry had been attacked by Wisdom and asked if I would take over his reporting and write an article on the attempted murder of Melissa Henry, and then write a biography of this man who in many in the newsroom had called their friend. I said yes, of course, and accepted the challenge. And upsetting though it was, dove into my new project with the anger I had rarely felt in my life. Journalists are meant to be impassive. I thought to myself, but I was furious that Ben Wisdom had conned his way into the lives of my colleagues and friends. I was insulted because I had liked him, and he was in fact a monster who preyed on girls and killed them for his sick pleasure. I decided I was going to write the best article I'd ever written, but needed to research his life. And so first of all, I went to Human Resources and asked my friend if I could borrow his file. Andrea agreed to let me borrow it under penalty so that I didn't let it out of my sight. I agreed and took it back to my desk.
The day Ben Wisdom escaped from custody, Superintendent Ron Bristow placed a call to Olivia Havisham at the FBI at her office in Washington, D.C. "Ollie, this is Ron Bristow from Chicago. Hi, how are you?" he started. "Oh, Ron, how great to hear your voice. I'm fine, thanks. What can I do for you?" Olivia replied. "Well, we have a serial killer in our midst, I'm afraid. His name is Ben Wisdom. Our mutual friend Chris Fenton managed to capture him in the act two nights ago. We then subsequently arrested him and put him in one of our squad cars, but he managed to escape and flee into the night. We have him on surveillance driving to Indiana, but we lost him in Gary. He's been accused of killing at least 9 young ladies in 2 different states, and I'm afraid we need your help to apprehend this lunatic. Is your caseload too heavy to take on another one?" Ron pleaded to his friend. "Well, of course we can do that, Ron. We are the FBI, after all," Ollie joked. "Why don't you send me over the details right away and I'll get him into our system immediately." "Oh, that'd be great, Ollie. I'd be so grateful to you. I fear he's now in the wind and may never return to Chicago. Frankly, good riddance, but I'm very sorry we didn't successfully apprehend him, as I fear for another innocent young lady in the future," Ron Bristow concluded. "My pleasure, Ron. I'll look for Mr. Wisdom's details momentarily." And Special Agent Olivia Havisham smiled and hung up. Special Agent Sam Peters was sitting in his boss's office as she was talking to Ron Bristow. His ears perked up when he heard the name Sir Christopher Fenton, and he fondly remembered his time working undercover in Chicago at R.M. Holmes as a plumber named Sam Manafort. During his stint there, he had met a woman also working undercover named Jenny Adamson in the office at R.M. Holmes. Jenny's real name, he found out later, was Lucy Dietremont, who co-owned the business called TMI with Sir Christopher and the investigative reporter Jamie Stroud. After the case he'd been working on wrapped up, he called Lucy up one evening and invited her to have dinner with him at Mama Cucina's Italian restaurant below the office of Triumvirate Investigations. To his great surprise, she accepted his invitation, and they had a wonderful meal and an almost romantic evening. The following day, his tour ended in Chicago, and he was transferred to FBI headquarters to work as Special Agent Olivia Havisham's equerry. Sam had stayed in touch with Lucy, and they chatted on Facebook and maintained a nice, if not somewhat frustrating, long-distance relationship. They both would have liked much more. Ben Wisdom had been at the Extended Stay America for 4 days now. He had paid in advance with cash for 14 nights at $49 a night. The room was on the second floor and overlooked I-75, 24 miles outside Detroit in Auburn Hills. The hotel allowed him privacy, and he found he could drive through any number of restaurants and bring his meal to the room. If he felt like Mexican food, there was a restaurant less than a mile away, so he felt secure that he knew the police were looking for him. As long as he was cautious, he could ride out the next 2 weeks privately while he planned his next move. On the 5th evening of his stay, he took a risk and decided to drive over the Ambassador Bridge, which spanned the Detroit River, but most importantly, on the opposite side of the river was the city of Windsor, which was in Canada. He took his passport with him just in case, although he'd been told the Border Patrol didn't seem to check that much, and drove over the bridge towards Windsor. He considered this to be a dry run. He was stopped at the halfway point by a customs official who asked him what his business was in Canada. Richard Crichton answered that he was meeting some friends at the Taste of India Tandoori on University Avenue in Windsor at 8 p.m. The officer looked at his passport cursorily, then waved him on with a, "Have a good night, sir," and before you could say Jack Robinson, Ben Wisdom was in Windsor, Canada. He was tempted to keep driving, but thought better of it, and actually showed up at the Indian restaurant and enjoyed the first decent meal he'd eaten in a few days. After dinner, he drove over the bridge, making certain the same customs official saw him returning. He paused for a moment and with a big smile told the man he'd really enjoyed the Taste of India. The customs officer smiled back at him and waved him through as Richard Crichton. He said good night and he'd see him in a couple of days. Wisdom then returned to his hotel and slept like the dead, pleased with himself for pulling off the journey. Daniela Mendoza read the letter that Sophia Hernandez had placed on her bed the night she left for Canada. She had written that she was sorry to be leaving her all alone, but she was scared that if they got caught, they would get into more trouble, so she felt it best to escape by herself. She promised her that if she made it across to Canada, she would let authorities know there was another girl in Niagara who had been separated from her mother. Sophia promised she would help her. Daniela began to cry. On the day that Maria and Sophia Hernandez officially became residents of Canada, the young girl mentioned her friend Daniela Mendoza to Joel Siegel. Sophia had really not mentioned her up until this point, so the moment Joel heard her name, he realized that Daniela must be important to her, and so he listened intently. From what she told him, the little girl was in the identical situation as Sophia had been in. He wrote all the details down on his notepad and promised Sophia that he would look into it as soon as he got home. Sophia and Maria, for the first time in a long time, were happy. Maria was doing well, learning English at the school, and had recently got a job working at an upscale store in Toronto called Nordstrom's. Sophia had been enrolled in the local elementary school and had just started to ride the bus every day. Their home was a wonderful sanctuary. Now that Maria had a job, she had become once again the bubbly, vivacious, and beautiful young lady she had once been when she was living in Guatemala. Joel got off the phone with HHS. After weeks of fruitless searching, he found out that Guadalupe Mendoza had been deported back to Guatemala 4 weeks earlier. He eventually found the address for Daniela's mother, who was officially living with Daniela's grandmother, and wrote to her. It took 3 weeks for her to respond, but when she did, it wasn't good news. Unfortunately, after Mrs. Mendoza was deported on the second day, she was home staying with her mother in the small village she had grown up in. A gang abducted, raped and killed her just as stones were away from the house where she was staying. There was a small funeral in the village, but the police, although they knew who carried out the murder, had no appetite to prosecute the gang members. It was chalked up to another senseless death in the war on violence. Ben Wisdom crossed over the Ambassador Bridge several more times over the next few days, becoming just another Yank who liked to party with his friends in Windsor. He finally packed up his things from the extended stay hotel and confidently drove across the bridge to begin his new life in Canada. By the time he did the final crossing, he was on a smile and wave relationship with the customs patrol, and they hardly even noticed him as he drove across the bridge and through Windsor, driving along Route 401 to London, and his final destination of Toronto, where Ben Wisdom, aka Richard Crichton, intended to reinvent himself. Toronto is a massive cosmopolitan city that sits on the banks of Lake Ontario. It's a city of 2.9 million residents, a dynamic metropolis with soaring skyscrapers that are dwarfed by the iconic CN Tower, 1850, 150-floor skyscraper with a revolving restaurant perched at the top. It was a city that Richard Crichton hoped that as long as he was careful, could get lost in and start his life again. Toronto is a young and vibrant city with a nightlife to die for, and Richard intended to take full advantage of his newfound freedom. It was, however, an expensive city, and he quickly found that unless he found himself a base quite fast, his money would run out. So once again, he booked himself into a low-cost motel on the edge of town and began to look seriously for work and a one-bedroom flat to rent for a year. For the next couple of days, Richard scoured the want ads. He realized that he was not technically allowed to work in Canada, and so he was trying to find some manual labor that would be willing to pay him off the books. On his third day, he managed to get a job that fit the bill perfectly. He got a job working for an import-export agent Iranian man named Masood, who asked him to drive a delivery lorry and make deliveries to upscale department stores in the city and suburbs. He answered an ad in the paper and interviewed with Masood, who didn't care less whether he had papers or not. In fact, he never even mentioned it, but just assumed that Richard Crichton was Canadian. Armed with a job, he then began to look for a place to live and found a studio flat for $605 the following day in the Cabbage Town district of Toronto in a quiet, leafy residential part of downtown. It was available right away and included an underground secure parking lot for his car. He negotiated with the landlord, who agreed to Crichton's offer of paying the rent up front for a 10% discount, and he moved in lock, stock and barrel the following day. By the time he was finished, he was exhausted. Given that it was Saturday the next day and he didn't start his new job until Monday morning, he went to bed that night and woke up at 10:30 p.m. Sunday feeling great. The case had gone cold back in Chicago. Ben Wisdom had disappeared without a trace, and Chris felt frustrated that he had solved the case only to have Wisdom escape at the last moment. Jamie Stroud had written him an impressive feature on the guy, having talked to dozens of police investigators in Chicago as well as in South Carolina. The investigation had grown somewhat as two more murders that bore similar fingerprints had surfaced in Charleston a year earlier, when Wisdom was living with his parents and in high school. Ben Wisdom owned a red Ford Mustang back then, a present to him from doting grandparents. The vehicle was seen close to both crime scenes, but had been ignored when it was first noticed. No one apparently bothered to connect the fact that the same vehicle was at two separate crime scenes. After all, the owner was just a kid.